Secretary Gates, Secretary Napolitano, Bob Mueller, Director of the FBI, and I sat down and created what's called the bubble chart for roles and responsibilities for the federal government. And what that did was help identify the lanes in the road, what your roles and responsibilities were. So FBI, law enforcement for cyber and cyber-related events. Homeland Security was to protect, and think of this as incident response, and setting standards for things like the NIST framework, getting people, and being a public face for the rest of the country coming into government. But the Defense Department's job is to defend the nation. And that's often confused, but one that absolutely has to be right. Why? If there is a cyber attack on our country, the chance that it goes from cyber to other forms of power will probably go fairly quickly. And the only ones that have the capability to attack back are in the Defense Department and the intelligence community. So it's there that the capability lies, but it's often confused. In fact, in the Presidential Commission, we found that many of the stakeholders in the different departments confused their roles and missions. So one of the findings from the commission was, you've got to get your roles and responsibilities right. Because whoever's responsible for defending the nation, DOD and the IC, if it's attacked, you're accountable. So you need to train, practice, and get that right.
You know, one of the things I try to look at is, where are there forces that are even outside of security that are affecting what we're doing? And one of the items that I'll give you sort of a thing I'm excited about and a thing that scares me. What I'm excited about is the speed at which we can do transactions today. So we had a big, the financial industry in the U.S. went to a big transition with this thing called Check 21, which basically means that you can use the image of the check, the scanned image, to facilitate a transaction instead of having this paper move around the country. And the requirement that transactions close within days was actually really taxing on the systems, as we know it, as you're probably aware of. And then you look at Bitcoin today, which means that, you know, basically if the blockchain gets three more nodes, you generally consider that transaction to be valid, which means it's about 30 minutes to kind of moving money. And there's a lot of things that cryptography actually gives us in doing this. Bitcoin is an example, and I think there's a lot of reasons why it might not, probably won't take off in the exact form it's in. But it's sped up the transaction cost. You can create an entity, you can move money quickly. The time to be able to store information, store a transaction, retrieve a transaction is actually pretty quick. But what's really, really interesting is that the time to truth is actually much faster. Mm. So if you were to go to the county clerk's office today to go get the title deed to my house, you'd have to wait in line and you'd have to retrieve this information and you could actually see that the house belongs to me. Is that enough proof? Not actually. To actually prove the house belongs to me, you probably got to go to court and have a trial and have 12 ordinary people decide the house belongs to me. And so we built a lot of these human systems around the fact that we have, there's 1% of house transactions that don't go well, and we have to account for those transactions that go to court, and we build a lot of processes around that. When you look at some of these more modern systems like the blockchain, what we're actually doing is figuring out how to codify certain human relationships in code, in a way that computers can parse them, and we have consensus-based systems that sort of rest on and rely on these. And so the net result is we do transactions a lot faster, and it actually means that you still need to be careful, but you need to be careful up front as opposed to hiring a bunch of lawyers in the back end, right? So that I think is an area of tremendous change, and I think you can see that in many, many areas. The kind of more scary thing about security is we're entering a world where reputation is as important or more important than confidentiality. And the speed of reputation and the speed of how that's managed is going to make this conference look very different in the next 10 years. We're about 2 years away from systems that will analyze, you know, your Facebook live feed, maybe a celebrity's video, and generate very compelling fake video. So real that I won't be able to tell that wasn't my birthday party. Right? And And what else can you do with that? And so I don't even have a technology solution for that, other than I think that's going to change how we, as a society, look at some of these points of truth and how organizations have to now manage these sort of new disturbances.
On executive orders, my philosophy on the executive orders, and you know, first of all, we've got three branches of government for checks and balances, right? So the executive orders typically compel departments and agencies. You can't compel those of us in the room as individuals to do things through executive orders unless you're at the department and agency. But my opinion, my advice to the new administration would be, first of all, on the executive orders, do single-purpose executive orders that make sense. The leaked ones, the leaked drafts, are everything but the kitchen sink. There's a lot of things with 90 to 100 days. And the executive orders, in my opinion, my humble opinion, should be a call to action. We have studied this problem for a long time. We have a lot of really smart people, from people sitting here to people in the industry, who have sat on task forces for the Bush administration, Clinton, for Obama, and there's plenty of binders illustrating the well-known problems. It is actually time to act. And so my bias would be towards very simple, very straightforward, very single-purpose EOs that are biased to action. So providing the last State of the Union you had for a department and agency, providing the roadmap of how you're going after it, doing listening sessions and asking departments and agencies and the industry, why can't we solve these problems? I mean, I was sitting with some of my colleagues yesterday and we said, last 10 years, name one security problem that's actually gone. Gone, and we don't even need to talk about it anymore. There's not one.
One of the biggest issues that we in this industry need to really start addressing is how do we protect what I call the cyber have-nots, right? You have, you know, in my experience with the DNC, this became very, very clear to me. People say, well, how come DNC did not have more people in cybersecurity, et cetera? They actually had zero people in cybersecurity. And worse than that, they had zero people in IT because they actually outsourced their IT. And the reason they had that is because they're a very small organization, despite being a political party. They're actually a nonprofit whose only responsibility is to fundraise money so that you can give it to candidates that the Democratic Party is trying to elect in Congress, similar on the Republican side. The entire staff of that organization rotates through every 2 years, right? There's no consistency, and how do you protect an organization like that? It doesn't have the funding, doesn't have the personnel, and never will to do cybersecurity and yet face some tremendous enemies. And there are lots of, you know, nonprofits, small businesses around this country that are struggling with these issues. And, you know, I don't worry about the big banks on Wall Street. They have the money, they have the personnel, they're going to be fine, they have access to a lot of great solutions that our companies are building. But what do you do for these small organizations that need help and will never have the talent or the expertise to do so? And it's the same way even for many U.S. government agencies. We really need as an industry to tackle that problem hard.
Why is it so hard for the private sector? Like you said, the big companies, they've got it nailed. They've got really talented people and solutions. It's sort of the small to medium-sized businesses. Why do you think it's so hard? And I said, well, first of all, how about an R&D tax credit for companies who actually invest money in cybersecurity? Like, it's always about the stick, right? I mean, if you think about the news headlines, did you ever see a news headline that said, poor Target, they were a victim of a crime, data breach happened right before, you know, the shopping holidays? Did anybody see them call a victim of a crime? But they were. So the second thing is, you, as soon as a data breach happens and it's big and massive, you march the CEO up on the hill and it's basically a firing squad on the hill where everybody wants to show people at home they're going to get tough on business. And we all forget they're a victim of a crime. So I would also like to see this administration look at how do we actually incent the behaviors we want, and things like R&D tax credits for hiring a security person, for investing in security technology, I think could be a really good way that when a business owner or a nonprofit is trying to stretch their dollars the furthest and they think, well, I should spend money on this, and by the way, it's going to come back to me in some type of a break and maybe even some type of a safe harbor, like I tried to do the best I could, and despite that, bad things happened.